All right. Good morning, everyone. It is so good to be with you here on this very first Sunday of 2021. We finally made it. We finally turned over into the new year. And I hope and pray that this will be one of our best years ever. Thank you for joining us. If you're watching, make sure you like, subscribe, and comment. Let us know that you're watching. A special shout out today to the Ablas in Illinois who are watching today. I just got a text from them saying that they were tuning in. So thank you guys for tuning in today. 2021 is here. Hey, teens, tonight our youth group will be going on at 5:30. You'll be getting an email with the link to join in on that, and so I hope you will participate. Wednesday night, we have coffee and chat at 6 o'clock. Please make sure you carve out some time to join us online. We always have a great time on Wednesday nights. Board meeting will be next Sunday afternoon on the 10th. I shared a little bit last week how we had decided to be online only this Sunday and next Sunday, and then we'll be making a determination next Sunday when we meet. And so be praying about that. I am ready to move forward. We're excited about the great opportunities and challenges that we have in 2021. Thank you for your continued giving. As always, you can use our Tithely app. You can download the Tithely app and look up Owensboro First Church of the Nazarene, or you can mail in your giving direct or drop it off throughout the week. But thank you for continuing in your giving. Today is actually 5-year anniversary to the day of me being installed as the pastor here. And what a privilege and an honor it is to be here. I'm thankful for you. I'm thankful for this church. And it just doesn't seem possible that we've already spent 5 years together. It seems like a lot longer than that. But I guess when you're surrounded with family and friends, time just kind of stands still. So anyway, also one other thing, we have upgraded some technology over the holidays. We are actually streaming in 1080p. There may be some buffering. You may have to do a refresh. Today, hopefully, we've got all the cobwebs worked out. But as always, technology works great for churches through the week. And then when you go live on Sunday morning, there's a little glitch or a hiccup. But we are streaming. We are moving forward with our technology. And we are thankful for all those who gave up some of their holiday time in order to make that happen. Well, we're going to pray, and then Andy is going to come and lead us in worship. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for 2021, for a new year of hopes and dreams. Father, we ask God that on this new Sunday, this new year, Father, that you would be with us. I know many people are setting resolutions and thinking about things that they want to do differently. I think one thing, Father, that this last year has really shown us is what really matters. And Father, I pray that we would take the things that we've learned in 2020 and we would use those to our benefit in 2021. Help us, Father, to be the men and women that you've called us to be. We pray, Father, that everything that is said and done would be pleasing to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
It's great to be here with you again today. I do miss Matthew. He might turn me down, just a hair, I'm ringing a little bit. We're going to go ahead and sing today, and I want you to sing with me, and I'm going to be able to tell today if you're singing or not, okay, because I'm looking. Believe me, I can tell, and I'm going to make you sing out loud in front of everybody if you don't sing today with me. I can hear you. I can see you. Of course, I'm kidding. But aren't you proud that we're entering a new year under God's amazing grace again today? I'm so happy and so thankful. Thank you. those chains to be broken in this year. If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lie. If you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. Yes, there is. There's a better life. If you got pain to maintain, if you feel lost, thank you.
Thank you, Andy. What a way to kick off the new year in praise and worship to our King. Well, today we are continuing in our series in the book of Genesis. Last week, we kind of kicked off a week early looking at chapter 1. This week, we're going to look at chapter 2 and chapter 3. It's been said that everything you need to know about life can be found in the lessons taught throughout the book of Genesis. This series in the beginning will kind of put that premise to the test. And I have no doubt that Genesis will pass with flying colors. Last week, we saw how God created the heavens and the earth and all that's within it. And we saw that his response to everything that he created was to say that it was good. This week, we'll hear him say, for the first time, that something isn't good. And we'll see something take place that, isn't good at all. We'll learn what God plans to do about it. Today's story, emphasis, kind of has three stages, or three acts. And then God kind of steps in. But let's see what happens in Genesis chapter 2 and chapter 3 in this first phase, this first stage of the story. And we see kind of the first act is life as it should be. Life as it should be. You could say life as it was meant to be. A life that it was meant to be lived out. Genesis 1 is an overview of the creation story. Genesis 2 goes into a little more detail. It even refers to God in more intimate terms. Genesis chapter 1 uses the word Elohim to refer to God. Genesis chapter 2 uses the name Yahweh Elohim. And it would be thousands of years later into the second installment of Moses' five-part series before the reader is fully able to understand the significance of the name of Yahweh. But the writer introduces it here to emphasize this personal nature of God's interaction with his creation. Everything about Genesis chapter 2 shows us what life was supposed to be like. God has placed this man, Adam, in this setting that can only be described as paradise. And he puts him to work. And that's a good thing. Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. Now the word translated work here can be also translated dungeon. This is a good thing. Now there are some people who think, based on events that you know are coming later in this message, that work is a curse. But work is not a curse. It's a blessing. This is why King Solomon said in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 12 and 13, I know that there is nothing better for men than to be happy and to do good while they live, that everyone may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all his toil. This is the gift of God. God put Adam to work in the garden, so that Adam could find satisfaction in his toil, the joy of a hard day's work. And then for the first time ever, God says that something isn't good. Look at verse 18. The Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. Now, by the way, just a little pause. The word helper here does not mean subservient. This word in Hebrew is ezer, and it's the same word that describes the help that God gives us. And so clearly, this is not about subserviency. The story kind of continues in a dramatic fashion in which God creates all the animals, and Adam, he names each one. But of course, none of them are suitable to be Adam's partner in life. Chapter 2, verse 21. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Verse 22. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. The man said, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. And verse 24, that is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. You see, this is how God intends it to be, that a man and a woman should be together, partners for life. Now, does this mean that no one will be single? No, it doesn't. As we see elsewhere in Scripture, there are some who are called to a life of celibacy or solitude. But generally speaking, God's plan is that a man and a woman would be together as husband and wife. That's the ideal. And there's another aspect of life, as it was meant to be, that we can see in the garden scene. Adam and Eve, they lived in fellowship with God. And in chapter 3, it refers to God taking a walk in the garden in the cool of the evening. And I really love that image. You kind of get the impression that this was not an uncommon thing, that God was there in the garden with Adam and Eve, and that they had fellowship together. It was what anyone would consider the perfect existence. There was meaningful work. There was fulfilling relationships. And there was this ongoing, unlimited connection with the God who created them. But there was one stipulation. Verse 16, "And the Lord God commanded the man, 'You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat it, you will certainly die.'" The second chapter of Genesis closes with Adam and Eve living the dream. And this is how the writer sums it up in verse 26. "The man and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame." You see, this phrase is packed with so much symbolism. Adam and Eve were living life as it was meant to be. And then a monkey wrench gets thrown in here. And this takes us to the second stage of the story, where we see that life takes an ugly turn. In the beginning of chapter 3, we meet a new character, the serpent, who is craftiest of all the creatures. Now, when someone is called crafty, it's never to be meant to be taken as a compliment. The serpent has a conversation with Eve. But the Bible says that Adam is right there with her. And he uses plural forms in the Hebrew, which indicates that he's talking to both of them. And he's talking about the only rule that they have been given: stay away from the apple tree. Well, actually, the Bible doesn't name the fruit specifically. But you know what? I think you know what I'm talking about. As the serpent talks to Adam and Eve, we see in their conversation a point-by-point study in the science of temptation. And I'm going to tell you that it still rings true today. Temptation hasn't changed in this many thousands of years. It's the same as it ever was. If you've ever given in to temptation, and let's be honest, we all have, you'll really recognize this process. And if you keep this in mind, that this is the process of temptation, it will help you the next time you're tempted. The first thing that the serpent did was to cause them to question what God had said. Chapter 3, verse 1. "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" This is where temptation begins. You question what God has said. Well, did God really say that I can't do this? I mean, is this really so bad? I mean, is it such a terrible thing that I yell at my kids, or I lie to my boss, or I occasionally go out and get hammered on the weekend, or whatever your particular temptation at the time might be? The first step in temptation is to get you to say, "Is this really a rule? Because if it is, it shouldn't be." It's a first step in temptation. Then in effect, this is what the serpent said to Adam and Eve. Chapter 3, verse 2. "The woman said to the serpent, 'We may eat from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that's in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die.' 'You will not certainly die,' the serpent said to the woman. 'For God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good from evil.'" This is the next step, the next trick that the devil has up its sleeve. He'll question what God has said, and then he'll flat out contradict it. "Oh, you won't die." This is what happens during temptation. That voice will whisper in your ear, "Nothing bad will come of this." The so-called consequences are made up. In fact, if you do this, your life will be so much better. You'll be in charge. You'll get to call your own shots. Now, I could spend a very long time talking about the many ways that we see the enemy contradicted in our cultural values from what God has said. But let's look at a couple that might really hit close to home to us. Jesus said, love your enemies. Sometimes we have a tendency to treat this commandment as if it's optional or non-existent. Sometimes we think it's okay to despise people because, you know, we're right and they're wrong. We're good and they're bad. Jesus said that we should never speak to others with words of contempt. And yet, when an employee is late on a project, or if the waiter doesn't get your meal just right, or the kids don't do what you're supposed to do, for some people who are otherwise quite religious, it's like that rule never existed. And that's what temptation does. It lures its victims in, saying, well, God never said that. And if he did say it, he didn't mean it. And even if he did mean it, well, God's just flat out wrong. You see, temptation wants you to question what God has said and to contradict what God has said. And then, at that moment that you are the most vulnerable, temptation wants you to think about it. And temptation wants you to think about it often before you rule it out. Chapter 3, verse 6. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. Good for food, pleasing to the eye, desirable for gaining wisdom. Now these are excellent things, aren't they? I mean, what could possibly go wrong? You see, temptation and the one who's behind temptation is like that certain kind of salesman who's offering a product that you don't really need and you can't really afford. He doesn't want you to think about the payments or the price tag, what a strain it could be on you financially. He just wants you to think about all the theoretical benefits that his product can offer. Prestige and comfort and style and security. And the devil knows that if you'll just think about it, if you'll just consider it long enough, you'll get around to doing it. That's why Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, verse 28, I tell you that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Now he's saying that the thinking something bad is just as destructive as doing something bad. Why? Because thinking it leads to doing it. It's like Jesus is saying, if you think about doing something wrong all the time, it's as good as done. It's like what Emerson said. He said, we become what we think about all day long. Now, I'm not talking about those moments of fleeting moments when we're tempted. I'm talking about dwelling on those temptations and thinking about those temptations and rolling it over and looking at it in different ways and constantly marinating on it. So we see this process at work in Adam and Eve, questioning God, contradicting God, thinking about all the reasons why they should disobey. And then, after Eve gave the matter some thought, verse 6, she took some and she ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. What happened next? Chapter 3, verse 7. And then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Friends, I want you to understand that the result of the breach in what God had said was not wisdom. It was shame. It was shame. The serpent has nothing more to say to Adam and Eve. He considers his work done. And yet Adam and Eve feel the need to cover themselves. And then when God comes to walk in the garden in the cool of the evening, They feel this urge to hide. Indeed, life has taken an ugly turn. And just when you think that it can't get any worse, we enter the third stage, the third act. Now comes the dreaded aftermath. When God comes walking in the garden in the cool of the evening, He calls out to Adam, "Where are you?" Adam said, "I was naked. I was ashamed, so I hid from you." God asks him, "Well, who told you you were naked? You haven't been eating any of that fruit, have you?" Adam's response has been used countless times throughout history. Genesis chapter 3, verse 12. "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it." He was saying, in essence, that this is Eve's fault. And not only is it Eve's fault, God, it's your fault. Because God, you are the one who brought Eve into the picture. Well, God then turns to Eve and says, "Well?" And Eve's response has been used countless times throughout history. She said, chapter 3, verse 13, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." You see, Eve was the first person to say, "The devil made me do it." This is the first part of the aftermath of the fall. And friends, I really want you to understand this. We have a tendency to place blame whoever, whenever we can. We do. We have become masters at saying, "It's not my fault. In fact, the more I think about it, it's your fault." And friends, you don't have to look very far to really understand that we live in a blame-addicted world. God, however, He didn't accept any of their excuses. He dealt with the serpent, and we'll look at that in a moment, but He also dealt with Adam and Eve. Now, in effect, He said, "There's going to be some fallout because of what you've done. Eve, childbearing will be difficult, and labor will be painful, and you'll find yourself in a constant power struggle with your husband." And then He turned to Adam and said, "The ground is cursed because of you, and it's full of thorns and thistles, and your work will be painful, and you'll survive by the sweat of your brow, and when your life is done, you'll go back to being dust." And then He invited Adam and Eve to vacate the premises. Chapter 3, verse 23. "So the Lord God banished him from the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which he had been taken." This is the fallout of the fall of man. This is the dreaded aftermath. Adam and Eve would go on to raise a family. Their sons were named Cain and Abel, and their family life would often be characterized by chaos. And that chaos would continue from generation to generation, and life would become more and more of a mess until the day God called on a man named Noah. But I'm getting way ahead of myself. Let's go back and think about that serpent. What about the serpent? Well, God told him that he would spend the rest of his day crawling on his belly and eating dust, like a snake. And then he said something that makes all the difference in the world, because it was a prediction. It was a foreshadowing. He said, chapter 3, verse 15, "I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel." Now, in the Hebrew grammar, it's clear that the offspring is referring to one individual. And he's saying to the serpent, in effect, "You will bite or bruise him on his heel, but only while using his heel to crush you into the ground." Maybe you remember the scene in the Passion of the Christ at the beginning when Jesus is praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, and the enemy is there to provoke him, and Jesus rejects him. Then he stands to leave, and the tempter is transformed into a snake, and Jesus stomps on his head with the heel of his foot. That's what God was talking about in Genesis chapter 3. He was talking about the crucifixion, the death of Jesus Christ. This was a minor victory for Satan. He bit him on the heel. But then came a crushing blow. On the third day, Jesus rose from the grave because death could not hold him by its power, and Satan was crushed. Since the days of Eden, Satan has been a defeated foe. The victory is ultimately ours through Jesus Christ. Paul said in Romans chapter 5, verse 12, sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin. He was talking about Adam. And he says, consequently, just as one kind of trespasses result in condemnation for all people, so also kind of one righteous act results in justification for life for all people. Romans chapter 5, verses 18 and 19. For just as though the disobedience of the one man, the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man, the many will be made righteous. This is the promise of God for all people everywhere. Today, in 2021, we're living in the aftermath of the choices that Adam and Eve made. But let's not lay all the blame on them. There's a sense in which their story is our story. We've all made the same choice. We have all chosen with intention to disobey God. We're all sinners. Romans chapter 3, verse 23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Death and sin entered the world through Adam, and today we live in the dreaded aftermath, in a world that's not as it should be. And we're chained to sin in a way that God never intended for His creation. So, what can we do about it? Well, you begin by surrendering your life to Jesus Christ. He died on the cross to pay the price for your sins. And then He rose from the grave, crushed the serpent's hold, putting an end to whatever claim your old life may have had on you. Oh, the serpent, he still comes around from time to time, trying to get you to question and contradict. Try to get you to think about considering a life of disobedience. But you see, the enemy, he doesn't look like he used to. He slithers now. His head is flat, like it has been stomped by the heel of Christ. It is 2021, the first Sunday of 2021, and I really want you to hear this. He is a defeated foe. You don't have to be his victim. We can make that decision now and every day. He's defeated. I don't have to be a victim. Romans chapter 5, verse 17. If by the trespass of the one man, death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. You see, this is God's answer to the dreaded aftermath. It's life in Jesus Christ. I was talking with someone this morning, and we were talking about new resolutions and thinking about, you know, what we're going to do to be better in 2021. I want to be more Christ-like because that yields a better result than if I just try to be a better me. In trying to be Christ-like, I become a better me. If I just focus on trying to be a better me, that never happens. Have I got a challenge for you in this new year of 2021? Three things that I want to challenge you to do and look for ways to do it. First of all, I want you to live now. Live right now. Don't think about what's going to happen next month, next year, a couple years from now. Right now, this day, in January 2021, live right now. Embrace the present. I also want to challenge you to love right now. Love right now. Not when someone asks for forgiveness. Not for when someone does what you think they need to do. I mean right now, in this day, this moment. Love now. Live now. Love now. And then God, that He would give us opportunities to serve now. Look for ways to serve right now. What does that look like for you? I don't know. But wherever you're at, God has placed you in a position where you can serve someone. You might say, well, hey, I'm stuck at home. I can't get out. But can you pick up the phone? Can you text? Can you call? Can you write a note? You'll never know how that might be exactly what that person needs right at that time. So I've thought about over the last couple of days, I see on Facebook that a lot of people are putting words with New Year's. So like 2020, I think my word was hope. Different people have different words. My word for 2021 is now. Now. I think if anything, 2020 taught us that we can't take anything for granted. And so I want to be in the moment. I want to live now. I want to love now. I want to serve now. That's my challenge to you as your pastor, is to embrace the idea of now. Live now, love now, serve now. Father, I thank You for Your word. I thank You for this journey that we're on, walking through the book of Genesis. I pray, Father, that You would give us opportunities to live out this now idea. Help us, Father, to live today, not thinking about the weekend, not thinking about next week or next month. But, Father, help us to embrace everything that is happening right now. I pray, God, that You would help us to love right now. Not a love that's dependent on what someone else's, what they do or what they say, but God, that we would just emanate love to those around us. And finally, Father, that You would help us to serve now. And I know in the church that looks so different because of some of the changes and the challenges that we face. But I really think it's helped us to take the focus off what happens in the building to what happens in our life. Every day, we have an opportunity to serve those around us. Right. It's not just the pastor's job or the Sunday school teacher's job, but Father, we are all called to love and serve our fellow man. And so God, help us this week, even today, Lord, to look for opportunities to serve. Live now, love now, serve now. Thank You, Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, again, church, I want to tell you, I am blessed to be your pastor. I love you. If you have any prayer needs or prayer requests, don't hesitate to reach out in Facebook message or text. You can even snail mail, but if you have a prayer need, if you have something going on in your life you'd like for us to pray about, please don't hesitate to let us know. God bless you, and we'll see teens tonight, and I'll see the rest of you Wednesday night on Coffee and Chat. God bless you. Bye-bye.